Hi all, so we are going to continue with Chaucer, Wife of Bath's prologue. In the last section where we stopped, Wife of Bath was discussing the world of men, the world of patriarchy, where a woman will always be criticized regardless of what she is. If she's poor, she'll be considered a very bad value in marriage, which has no return. If she's rich, she'll be considered very arrogant and proud and very difficult to put up with. Even if she is just beautiful, she will be questioned on her virtues, and it will be said that men will seduce her and she will give in, and her virtues will be considered cheap. So whatever she is, she will be at the receiving end of men's criticism. And this is how a patriarchal world order operates. In this section, which is the seventh lecture of this series, it's called the Shrew's Proverb. Wife of Bath kind of continues with that tone, and is critical of this world of patriarchal setup. So let's move on in the text. And in the previous section, it was that women will be criticized for whatever they are, and this section deals with how men create standards for women in a patriarchal society. You say some men desire us for our gold, some for our shape, and some for fairness told, and some that she can either sing or dance, and some for courtesy and dalliance. So in a patriarchal world, in a patriarchal society, men create these standards, and it is women who are supposed to fit in. And if a woman can fit in, then she is the desirable woman in this world. And if she doesn't, she is left out. That is how the patriarchal society, the patriarchal world operates. And Wife of Bath asks this question, that why do men choose women, or how do men choose women? And this is not actually about choosing, it is about how, which women do men want to possess. And that is what it is. And the answer is that some men desire us here is the women. Some men desire us for our gold, means some men marry us for our money. Because through money, it is also men that gained a lot of property and money. So marriage for men were also a way to increase their riches, because women could not own property. So after marriage, and when the woman's father dies, the property was supposed to go to her husband. So that is how some men want to marry women for their money, some for our shape, and shape here means the feminine figure, the physical feminine body and body shape, and some for fairness. And fairness here means actually beauty, how pretty she is. So some men marry women for money, some men marry them if they have a very good figure, and some men marry them if they are pretty. So this is how in a patriarchal world body shaming occurs, because men have created in a patriarchal world, men create this body standards, that a woman is supposed to be slim, she's supposed to have a narrow waist. So these are standards that men create, and women should fit in for them to be more valuable in marriage, and some for fairness. And this can also, in our context, it can also be defined in terms of colorism. Colorism is kind of a racism. As you know, in our country, it is always fair who is considered beautiful. And women with dark skin colors are always kind of looked down upon. So there is an overarching market for things like fair and lovely and all. So women are desired more when they are fair, and these are standards that patriarchy has created, and this is the concept of the beauty standards against which Wife of Bath is ranting this in this section. And some that she can either sing or dance. Some men desire us when we can sing or dance. And the thing is, the tragedy is, sing or dance, a woman is more desired if she can sing or she can dance. So these are qualities that talents rather that women should possess in order to be more valuable. But the tragedy is this singing or dancing, these women cannot pursue as careers. Like, these are not learned by the women in Chaucer society to actually pursue them as careers. Rather, these are learned, women learn to sing or dance to be actually more valuable in the marriage market. So if a woman can sing or dance, she will be more desired by men, and that is why she learns to sing or dance, not because of herself, not because she wants to pursue these as careers, even not because she loves to sing or loves to dance. So this is the tragedy of the patriarchal world. And some for courtesy and dalliance. Courtesy and dalliance, these are manners and etiquette. And if you understand, yeah, obviously good manners is good. It should be good for everyone, for men and women. But manners and etiquette, the burden of manners, the burden of good manners and good etiquette is often very gendered. It is often, you know, burdened upon the women. Women are supposed to be very good mannered, very they should have the courtesy, they should not be loud, they should not be laughing very loud, they should not be very outspoken, they should not be aggressive, they should be calm. So these are standards which the patriarchal world order has created for women to fit in. So manners, which is supposed to be adapted, if it is good manner, is supposed to be adopted by both the men and women, but it is often women who are more burdened by this gendered form of manners and etiquette. So this is this list, this is the list which makes this section actually very powerful and very relatable to our present times. Some for her hands and for her arms so small. Thus all goes to the devil in your tale. You say men cannot keep a castle wall that's long assailed on all sides and by all. So some women are desired if her arms are small. So this actually tells us about the height of female physical refinement or modification that is needed to conform to the male ideals of beauty. Like, women should have narrow waists, women should have broad shoulders, I don't know, like slim thighs, and these are body parts which women need to work out and modify and refine. And why? Because to be more desirable by the man. And this standard of body, this standard of beauty is created by the patriarchal order, which women need to fit in. So this actually tells us about the height of female refinement that is needed to conform to the male ideals of beauty. And she says that you all goes devil in your tail, and this is all that you say. And women obviously are very, like, I don't know, furious about these wife of Bath is furious about these standards that are thrust and burdened on women to follow. And the irony is that you say men cannot keep a castle wall that's long assailed on all sides by all. Women need to fit in to the body standards. Women need to fit in the manners that are created by men. Women need to be more faithful, more loyal in a marriage. But the irony is, when it comes to men, they say that men cannot control seduction for very long. Women must be loyal in marriage, but men, if they are seduced by many women, it is very difficult for men to control it. So the wife is supposed to control her sexual adventures, her sexual adventures outside marriage. But when it comes to men, this restriction suddenly doesn't apply. And it is almost natural, she says, for a man that they will say that we cannot control seduction for very long. We cannot keep off seduction for very long. And men's loyalty is kind of portrayed as a castle. And a castle, if it is assailed on all sides, it is attacked from all sides, means if a man's loyalty is attacked by all seductions from other women, it is very difficult for a man to control. But a woman should always control, be loyal in marriage. But for men, it is not so, not quite so. And if that she be foul, you say, and this is the next section in this lecture that we come in, and if that she be foul, you say, that she hankers for every man that she may see, for like a spaniel she will leap on him until she finds a man to be victim. And this is a very hard, this is a very dirty misogynist attack on women. And men say like this, if she be foul, if a woman is ugly, and ugly in terms of the beauty standards that men have created, she hankers for every man. Like ugly women, they do not have a choice. They will lust for every man they see. They will want to make out with every man they see, for ugly women. And like a spaniel, she will leap until she finds a man to be victim. These ugly women, they are like dogs, and they will jump on every man until she finds a man who is willing to do it with her. And this is a very misogynist attack on women that Wife of Bath says that she has faced, and almost all women have faced in that age. And not a grey goose swims there in the lake, but finds a gander willing her to take. You say it is a hard thing to enfold her whom no man will in his own arms hold. And so she says men say that there is not a grey goose which swims in the lake, like there is no woman who is so ugly that any gander is willing her to take, that she won't be taken by any man. There is no woman in the world who is so ugly that she won't be taken by any man. However ugly she is, she will still get a man to do it with her. And it is a very hard thing to unfold. It's very hard to find a woman who is so ugly that no man will want to have her. So this is how men attacks women, and men attacks women, especially women who are ugly in their standards. So these are the misogynist attacks that are there in Chaucer's contemporary society, that are common in popular in Chaucer's society. Women who are not fitting in the men's standards of beauty are women who are ugly. So, and ugly women, they say, they are attacked, and they are said that they are denied the faculty of choice. Like a beautiful woman, a pretty woman can choose a man whom she wants to be with, but for an ugly woman, she will, like a dog, leap on to every man that she sees until she finds a man who is willing to do it with her. And so the ugly women, she doesn't have a choice. They will do it with anyone. That's how Wife of Bath says that men attack women. What is very important here is the animal imageries that that men use, as Wife of Bath says, that men use to describe women. The first is foul, as you see, it's there in this section, as if that she be foul. So a fowl is kind of a bird, a chicken kind of bird, which is eaten. A spaniel is a dog, a grey goose. So these are some animals, these animal imageries, which Wife of Bath says that men compare woman with. And you will probably relate if I say like this, that in the present day these still exist, and women are called in animal names. They are called chick, women are called bitches, So it's very common. You'll see in our society that women are abused like she's a bitch, and look at her, she's a hot chick. And this is how women are compared with animals. So that is putting woman in a very low light. So this is the misogyny that exists in Chaucer's society as well, and that is what comes across in this section. This you say worthless when you go to bed, and that no wise man needs thus to be wed. No, nor a man that hearkens unto heaven with furious thunderclaps and fiery leaven. And when the husband goes to bed, they say these things that it is the worst thing on earth is marriage. Because the husband says like this when he goes to bed, it kind of points to domestic fights that are common between married couples, but kind of precedes the theme of domestic violence in this text. And remember that PDF which I uploaded in Google Classroom that had all the themes and the issues that arises from this text, Wife of Bath's Prologue as a whole, and domestic violence was one of the issues. So this is kind of pointing and kind of precedes the episodes of domestic violence that are there in this text. So when you go to bed, when a man goes to bed, they say that no wise man needs thus to be wed. So they say the wise men won't marry because there are only sufferings in marriage. A marriage is all about suffering, all about misery. So only a fool will choose to marry. So this is how the husbands say. No man that hearkens unto heaven. And men say that any man that considers going to heaven should not consider marriage. Why? Because although she doesn't tell it directly, she says furious thunderclaps and fiery leaven. So these means thunderbolts, and these probably hints at some images of violence. And thunderclaps and fiery leaven, and which means thunderbolt, kind of tells us about the slaps and the attacks, that the physical attacks, the violence that men actually do to women in marriage. So this episode actually precedes the episode of domestic violence that will be here, that we'll study later on in this text. And men doesn't take the blame. The men in this patriarchal culture, they do not take the blame for this domestic violence, and they say that it is the suffering in marriage that will provoke him to actually commit the violence and these crimes. So they won't be able to go to heaven because they will commit these crimes. And men as if are pushed to violence because there is so much misery and suffering in marriage. So even when the women is at the receiving end of this violence, the blame for this violence will be on women only, because it will be said that it is women and their manners which will provoke a man or a husband to commit the crime or the violence. And then Wife of Bath goes on to a rant because she is very enraged by this culture of patriarchy and domestic violence. May your thin, withered, wrinkled neck be broke. And in the last section, this section, there are two proverbs that Wife of Bath will say. And the first is that you say that dripping eaves, and also smoke and wife's contentious will make men to flee out of their houses. So this is the first proverb. And this is the second proverb, that we wives our vices hide till we are married, then we show them well. That is a scoundrel's proverb, let me tell. So these are the two proverbs that Wife of Bath says, that proverbs that carry this sense of the misogyny. So this is the shrew's proverb, and Wife of Bath says that these are the scoundrel's proverb. And a shrew is a bad-tempered and aggressive and assertive woman who was always at the receiving end of men's criticism. Men wanted in a patriarchal culture, men wants women to be submissive, to be meek, and women were seen as a kind of a weak race, a race about weakness, a sex about weakness. And a bad-tempered, an aggressive, or a loud-spoken, assertive woman who is called the shrew was not at all liked by men in patriarchal cultures. So a shrew always needed to be tamed. And this is a kind of the anti-feminist theme that Wife of Bath's prologue also has. This is one of the themes. And so these are the meaning of the two proverbs that Wife of Bath says. The first one, that dripping eaves and also smoke and wives contentious will make men to flee out of their houses. It means the sight of a leaking roof, the smell of smoke and wife scolding. These are enough to make men flee his home. So this is a kind of a joke on women, and this is a popular proverb. And the second one is wives, they hide their vices till they are married and then we show them. They hide their vices, their bad manners until they are married, and when once they are married, they then start showing their true colors. So these are the two misogynist attacks on women that proverbs carry. And proverbs are popular sayings of some of the times, and proverbs also carry this misogyny. And that is why Wife of Bath says that this is a scoundrel's proverb, and because these show women in poor light. So Wife of Bath, kind of in this section, she kind of rants against these expectations and standards that men have, and the misogyny that the culture is all about, and also these proverbs which furthers the misogyny. So this was the section. We'll continue with Wife of Bath in the next lecture. Thank you.